Well, good morning, church. So glad that you're here today, and we get to see your smiling face, and so happy to be in the Lord's house this morning. I wanted to tell you guys about something we have coming up, Easter, and we were just talking about that in staff meeting of like how we were going to invite people to Easter.
Hey, stop right there. I'm way ahead of you. Look, I've been making this poster. And we can make lots more of these posters, and we can even use them as invitations to hand out. But I'm going to need your help because they take a little bit to make. But let me just read it to you because I'm using terms that all of you guys are really familiar with right now. So it says, in-person or online attendance for Easter Sunday service is mandated by FBCO. And I use those initials because they sound really official and believable, and some people don't know what that is, and so they'll really think they have to come. And then up here, it says, avoid close contact with people who don't plan to come. So if you invite someone and they don't plan to come, don't hang out with them anymore. And then up here, it says, protect people at higher risk, which are those who think Easter is celebrating the Easter bunny and candy rather than Jesus. So we got to protect those guys. Invites only work if you share them. And now I have the dates up here, Saturday, April 3rd at 5 p.m. and Sunday, April 4th at 9:45 and 11 a.m. And then there's an Easter egg hunt that follows each service, but for your safety, stay 6 feet back from my candy. And then over here, protect yourself from eternal damnation, wrath and judgment, and the Easter blues. That's important. And then here at the very bottom, help stop the spread of lost souls going to hell and chocolate overload. So I think that's going to be well, awesome.
Erica, I think we all really appreciate your effort and your energy about Easter. But I think we might need to go in a little bit different direction. So we have these little invite cards that we've bundled in fives, and they're just little, and you just like hand them and you just invite somebody. It's real simple. Easter's going to be amazing, and we don't have to.
I think that would probably save time, but my poster would help trick way more people into coming.
Exactly. We're not really trying to trick people to come to church. We just want to invite them.
Okay, whatever.
And so, thank you, Erica. We have these invite cards that you guys can get at the Welcome Center. It's just bundles of five cards. You can hand those out, invite some people to Easter. We'd really love to see some awesome things. Jason, there's some other things going on as well.
Yes. Easter is going to be big. And thank you all so much. Thank you, Erica, for the energy. We like that energy leading up to Easter. And we're really praying and hoping that you're going to have that same type of energy of inviting people, because we believe God and know God's doing a lot of stuff here and has a lot of stuff planned for the next year. And I believe Easter's just going to be something that's just going to launch us up and move us forward. So make sure you pick up those invite cards. Make sure you realize and explain to people what we're doing this year. It's a little different than we've done before. We're going to have a Saturday night service at 5 o'clock with an egg hunt immediately following after that. Then we're going to have we'll have 9:45 service, and then we'll have an egg hunt following that, and we'll have an 11 o'clock service. Egg hunt following that. So we have that all lined out. There'll be no connection groups that Sunday. So come invite somebody. You can come to any of the three services. They're all going to be identical, so it doesn't matter which one that you come to. And what we're asking is to accommodate all these people, to be able to reach and minister to all the people coming. And like I said, we're looking forward to a full Saturday and Sunday services, is that we're going to need your help. So we're asking that you come to one of those three services. Then we're asking that you serve at one of those other services, that maybe you can help put eggs out. Maybe you could help with the preschooler children. Maybe you could help with parking lot. Maybe you can help with greeting, that whatever you could do to help that Easter. So we come and worship, so we also have an opportunity to serve. So if you look at our website, there's a place where you can go. We'll have it where you can sign up and tell us what areas you'd like to help with that. Also, I know it's kind of intimidating. Sometimes it's even hard just to give somebody a card and say, come, but look for the opportunity to do that. Also, for kids out there, or maybe if you have someone who has kids, we have these little kits out in the lobby that you can pick up. It says, you've been egged. Teenagers, listen to the instructions real carefully on that one, all right? It's not what first comes to your mind. But what it is there's 12 eggs in here. There's instructions in here that will tell you what to do. You're going to fill them. You're going to leave one of them empty, It represents the empty tomb. And then there's a little door knocker here. You'll hang these on there, and you'll kind of go to someone's house, give them a little Easter egg hunt. On the back of this door knocker gives them an invitation here for Easter Sunday morning. So it gives them an invitation for Easter Sunday or Saturday. So go to someone. There's also some chalk in here, so you can leave them a little message on their driveway. So it's a nice, fun way to invite people to come to Easter services. So a lot going on here for Easter. Also, we have next week. Maybe you've joined recently, or maybe you've been coming for a while, and you're like, how do I get to be a member of First Baptist Church? Maybe you have questions. I want to know a little bit more before I become a member of First Baptist Church. Starting next week, we have a class that'll start at 11 o'clock. You'll go have a class, break for lunch here. They'll have a special lunch for you. Meet a little bit afterwards, and it'll help fill in a lot of those questions that you might have. So if you're interested in joining in or being part of that, if you'll just sign up at the Welcome Center on the way out today. Also, I was a little worried when I woke up this morning, and I was getting my jacket out and thinking, okay, Lord, you told me it was going to be a beautiful day for a picnic. And the Lord went ahead and provided. The sun's come out, and it's a beautiful day out there. And we're looking forward to having a great fellowship this afternoon, immediately following the service. So what we're going to do is dismiss from here. If you can help break down, that'll be great. But we're going to go out to the pavilion out front up there. We've got some inflatables for some kids. We got some activities for the teenagers. John's playing some activities for the adults. And it's just a time of fellowship for us to get to hang out with each other, but also get to know Josh and Devin and the family. So maybe you're like, oh, man, I meant to sign up for that, or I meant to do that and didn't get to. We did order some extra meals. If you want to go to the Welcome Center, you can sign up for those. But we do have some extra meals ordered. So if you didn't do that, or if you had made plans, hey, I want to go and run to Chick-fil-A. Oh, I can't go to Chick-fil-A today. All right. If you want to go run somewhere else and bring something back here, you're welcome to do that too. But we're going to kick that off immediately following the service right out there. So stay. It's going to be a great afternoon. If you're our guest, we're especially glad that you're here with us today. Or if you're online, we're glad that you're tuning in today. You can text WELCOME to the number up there on the screen, and we'll shoot you some more information about First Baptist Church. I'd like to ask Brandon Fisher to come up at this time. He is our co-chair, treasurer, and he has some financial updates to give us. And First Baptist Church, we start our budget year 1st of April. So we have a business meeting next Sunday afternoon that will give approval to this budget, but we wanted to make sure that you had an opportunity to view it. So,
all right, I appreciate it, Jason. What a beautiful, beautiful morning. We've gotten a perfect day for a picnic. I know we're all excited when the treasurer comes up here for the church, but I'm Brandon Fisher. I'm the co-treasurer along with Susan Pivoteau. And so, real quick, I wanted to give a review of where our last budget ended. As Jason just mentioned, this is the last month on there. You can see the budget amount, and you never want to see red, and unfortunately, that's what we're seeing, is $191,253 short. Now with that, you see the spending difference of $52,463. And so what that is unfortunately we didn't collect what we wanted to, but we also didn't spend what we had budgeted to spend. And so that came with a shortfall of $52,463. So I think it's very important that the church sees that, and I'm encouraging y'all to give and to trust God and be faithful. If you go to the next slide, please. Some of those challenges, obviously 2020, when we all look back, we're gonna think of COVID, right? But not only in this area did we have COVID, which greatly impacted church attendance and giving to some extent, although I was very pleased that giving still was up, especially compared to a lot of the other churches I see. But then we also had two back-to-back hurricanes. So there was a lot thrown at us. Our online giving has increased. We were blessed enough to get a first round of a PPP loan that is going to be forgiven. We're in the process of getting a second one that is going to help out. If you'll go to the next one, please. So that's kind of where we are. Here's kind of where we're going. Right now for Connect, which is our missions, benevolence, outreach, and salaries, that's $192,607. Our worship budget is $92,443. The belong, which is your education, students, and the children, that's $234,000. Our serve, which is our health insurance, our bereavement, and staff development, is $315,000. And our support, which is our loan payment, property, utilities, and maintenance, is $445,000. obviously the church, we suffered some damage during those hurricanes I just mentioned, and we've been working through that, and the staff has done a great job with our insurance companies and really staying on that. Here's a bird's eye view of the numbers I just spoke about. You'll see here total budget recommended is $1,280,000. And you're going to say, okay, well, I just told you we didn't make budget last year. So why are you adding $5,321 to it? When we first looked at it, we were going to try to have a decrease of about $20,000. But one of the things was our budget, we never had the full loan payment for this building in our budget. When you look at here, the key changes, that is a big change. So overall, we added about $22,000 to the budget specifically to make that payment in there. So I wanted y'all to be aware that now when we look at the budget, this full amount is in the budget. So it's a true budget for us. We're excited to have that in there. That's definitely a leap of faith that the church is taking, putting that number in there. In the past, we've kind of used next step funds and other things to help subsidize that. So now this is the true budget. I'm eager. I'm encouraging y'all to trust the Lord and to give. You probably are going to get something in the mail. I know I got mine Friday. If not, you're going to have more of the detailed budget. But if you have any questions, please email info@fbc.org. Also, we're having our quarterly business meeting. That's next Sunday, the 28th at 3. Please come. This is God's church. This is y'all's church. Be involved. Know what's going on. If you have questions, please come. We're very transparent. We'd be happy to answer those. God bless.
Let me say that again. If no one has said this to you today, let me say I am glad you are here. I'm glad you've chosen to worship with us, and if you're online, we're glad as well that you have come, you've chosen to tune in. We want to worship the Lord. We want to honor Him. We want everything that we do to be for Him, about Him, and to Him today. So would you worship with us as we sing together?
Gone.
you be seated for a moment? You looked at that song and you said, what a friend. Oh, I remember that great old hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. And you found, oh, that's not the song that they were going to do. So just so you know, and just so you won't be too disappointed, we are going to do a gospel song with our men's quartet. So you'll give a listen as we sing together.
There is not another sister, friend, or brother close the way that Jesus can. He gave his life for me when he died on Calvary. He gave his life for fallen man. His love is a boundless love, and it reaches out and touches me. His love is an endless love that will last through all eternity. Jesus wants to love you. There is none above you. You are precious in his sight. He will never fail you when the doubts assail you. He'll be with you day and night. His love is a boundless love, and it reaches out and touches me. His love is an endless love, and it lasts through all eternity. His love is a boundless love, and it reaches out and touches me. His love is an endless love, and it lasts through all eternity. His love is a boundless love, and it reaches out and touches me. Yes, His love is an endless love, and will last through all eternity. His love is a boundless love, a boundless love.
amen, church. Isn't it good to be in the Lord's house this morning and to enjoy such a tremendous time of worship? I feel like every Sunday I can't help but brag on these amazing guys and the job that they do. Also want to thank Brandon for updating us on the church finances and kind of sharing where we're at, encouraging us and challenging us to give. One thing, when I first surrendered to the ministry, one of the things that I prayed was this, was, Lord, never let me ask somebody else to do something that I'm also not willing to do for myself. And so just about every sermon I preach to me first, and then I hope that it's a blessing to you as well. And then also when it comes to giving, something that I learned years ago is that every month, me and my wife, my family, are going to give our 10% to the Lord. Now, that's a number that we've picked, and people land in different places, but certainly the Lord encourages us to give. And so this morning, we are closing out a series, and then the next 2 weeks, we're going to be looking at that pinnacle event in Christianity, the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. But today, to start us off, I want to let you in on a little secret, okay? Now, I want this to stay in-house because if I ever get a book deal, this is going in the book. And I don't want anybody stealing, you know, what I know here, what I'm about to enlighten you on. And it's this. I have learned how to control the future. That's pretty amazing, right? Now, would you like to know how I do that? It's a simple process. To control tomorrow, I simply worry about it today. Fret over it, stress out over it, let my anxiety levels get really, really high. And that's what I do, and it pans out. Now, it must work because about 3/4, maybe more than that, of what I worry about never actually comes to fruition. It never comes to pass. Now, maybe you say, well, Josh, that's just really silly, and you're right, it is. But you know what is also silly is the time we spend fretting and worrying about the future, because it's not productive for us to be anxious about what is to come. And here's one thing I know. We live and a culture that is tremendously anxious and worried. And then the coronavirus rolls in, and it's like our anxiety went from here to here. And we do. We worry and we fret over many, many different things and allow ourselves to get worked up. And the media doesn't help, because very rarely do you turn on the news and you find, you know, somebody that's reunited with their lost puppy or, you know, something good that happens. Mostly, it's just doom and gloom, and bad things are going to happen, and it gets us worked up, and then sometimes we get worked up, and we post on Facebook so everybody else can get worked up and worried, and it's just this branching out effect. Now, are you with me? Because I do this too, so I'm telling you, I'm preaching to myself first. Now, I do think it's important as we talk about anxiety to define some terms. There is a clinical anxiety where it is, it's at a clinical level, and sometimes that requires medication. Sometimes that requires, you know, medical intervention. But we all are touched by worry, anxiety, fear, fretting about what's to come from time to time. And I think it's also important for us to understand this, that a small degree of anxiety is helpful. That's what got me through college is, man, if I don't study for this test tomorrow, it's not going to be good. So that anxiety kind of motivated me to study just a little bit. Some levels of fear are good. If I go into somebody's backyard and I'm met with a snarling Rottweiler that's ready to make a picnic lunch out of me, feet don't fail me now, I'm going to run. That fear motivates me to act. But there's this level of anxiety and worry that sometimes catches up with all of us that is just not a good thing. It's not healthy for us. It doesn't get us anywhere productive. But often, we let ourselves get to that place where we worry over things that are beyond our control, and we ask, well, what if this happens? Well, what if tomorrow holds this? On and on and on and on. And so, the earlier this week, as I was thinking about this sermon, I put this poll out on Facebook, and I'm going to ask you the same question. When I think about the future, I am most anxious about fill in the blank. So this is my question to you. When I think about the future, I am most anxious about you for yourself or your family, fill in the blank. Now, if you're like me, maybe you'll push back a little bit, because anytime I listen to somebody preach or teach, you know, the whole time I'm thinking, well, what about this and what about that? So maybe you're thinking, well, Josh, aren't there some things to be concerned about in the future? And you're right, there are, but this is what I often do. Often I mask my worry as concern. Well, it's not worry. I'm not being anxious. It's just I have concern for what's to come. And so often for me, that's my excuse to not trust the Lord with my tomorrow and to worry about what is to come, or maybe even to worry about what is, you know, in my life at that moment. And so I asked this question on Facebook, and I got a different response. Here's were some of the more popular frequent answers. One was religious freedom, that what if we lose that right to assemble together to worship in the United States. The state of the world that our kids will inherit, financial issues, which we probably all have those from time to time. My family being taken care of in the future, the state of the American church, because the church certainly has some shortcomings overall as, you know, the big C word, church. But here's the crucial thing we have to remember. All I can do as a person, as a Christian, is to plan and prepare for tomorrow, live as a Christian, stand on truth and love, and then understand that the future is beyond my control. But, you know, sometimes we still worry, and here's what I have to remember. That the Lord holds me in his hands. And the Lord holds my future. The Lord holds my future. And so today, every week, we've had an interview. I'm going to ask my friend and brother, Mr. John Martin, if you'll come. And we are going to have just a quick chat over this idea of worry and control and fretting over things. There you go, brother. All right, we're glad to have you up here this morning. And so if you don't fully know Mr. Martin's story, he was diagnosed with cancer. How many years ago has that been?
That was March of this past year.
This past, so 2020. Who was surprised that it was in 2020, right?
Yes.
It was that kind of year. So you received a cancer diagnosis, and we hate that word, right? And a lot of times we get news like that, and we tend to want to fret, and we tend to want to worry about it. Can you speak to us today and tell us how you made it through that period of time with that diagnosis and treatments and what that looked like for you?
Well, most of all, I depended on the Lord. And whenever I got the news that I had cancer,
right,
of the prostate, and the cancer that I had was moderately aggressive.
Okay.
So it was something I couldn't do without.
Yeah.
So I had a choice of several procedures of therapy treatments to try to rid myself of the cancer, and all of them had side effects,
right,
that were worrisome. So I just asked the Lord, I said, Lord, help me make a choice of which procedure I should proceed with.
Right.
And so I chose external radiation treatments.
Okay.
Which took about 42 treatments over about 2.5 months.
Right.
And 5 days a week. And so after going through those procedures, then I was declared cancer-free.
Which is great news, yeah.
Yeah.
Now, let me ask you this. That period of 2.5 months where you're having treatment, did you ever have days where you woke up and you thought, well, what if this treatment doesn't work? Or, you know, what if something goes wrong with the treatment itself and there are bad side effects? Did you ever have days where you worried?
Well, I was concerned.
Sure.
About them.
Yeah.
But they didn't come to fruition. Thank goodness.
Thank the Lord. So what did you do to navigate on those days where you might have been tempted to be anxious or to worry and fret over this?
I just talked with the Lord. I talk with him frequently.
I do too, and he's always ever present, right?
Yes, I pray, and just little prayers all day long.
And so on those days where you felt anxious, you just directed your attention back to the Lord, right?
Yes.
Back to the Lord. So to recap here, what I'm hearing you say is you got bad news, you could have worried and fretted, you did everything that you could do, that you knew how to do, and then you just,
yes,
trusted the Lord with the results.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Well, I think that's a testimony in and of itself. And is there any advice you would give us when we're tempted to worry or be concerned about what the future might hold?
Well, I have senior moments a lot.
Yeah, me too.
And I can't remember people's names. I can remember everything about them. And I ask the Lord, well, Lord, help me remember that name.
Mm-hmm.
And after a while, pretty soon, I'll remember that name.
So just continually diverting your attention back to the Lord.
Yes.
I think that's the secret. Brother, we appreciate your testimony,
yes,
and your time with us this morning. Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's always amazing to me when we get bad news that it might be a shock to us, it might be a difficulty to us, but the Lord is with us, whatever it is that we go through. And so this morning, as we close out this series and sort of land the plane, talking about, you know, Geronimo, amen, I want us to have walked away fully mindful of the fact that we can trust God with our families, that we can trust God with our finances, we can trust God with our future. There's not an area that we can uncover that we can't leave at the Lord's feet and trust him with. And Christians, we're the only people on earth that truly, truly have no reason to worry about what the future might hold for us. And so worry is just a complete waste of our time. And essentially, here's what it says when we worry. Worry says, God, I say I trust you, but deep, deep, deep down, I really don't. Now, again, I'm preaching to me more than anybody else because I have these moments. But a guy named Newt Scamander once said this. He said, worry makes you suffer twice. Worry makes you suffer twice. And that is such an amazing truth that, you know, half of what I worry about, it never comes to fruition. And that elicits suffering. But even the things that we do go through, not only do we have to suffer through it when it happens, but we have this whole period before it where we suffer through it because of our anxiety and our worry. And so this morning, I want us to take a look at what Jesus had to say about this topic. So if you have your Bibles, I'd love you to journey through with me. The book of Matthew, the first gospel, Matthew chapter 6. And we're going to start off with a little bit of context. This is Jesus' famous Sermon on the Mount. I can't imagine what it must have been like to sit under Jesus' teaching as he worked through these truths. And so Jesus is going to give us some insight on worry and what it means to trust the Lord with our future. But the immediate context here connects the dots of worry to a discussion on money. Jesus frequently talked about money, and he addressed, you know, every topic that we need to know about. But here's the context, Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. Jesus says, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. The Greek word here for money is mammon, which literally means stuff. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm a stuff guy. Like, I like stuff. You know, if I have a little extra jingle jangle in my pocket, I'll go buy some of that stuff that I like. And there's nothing wrong with stuff, and there's nothing wrong with money, but Jesus directs our attention to this, that you can only make one thing supreme in your life. And for most people, especially in our modern Western Americanized society, it's so tempting to put our stuff above the Lord and above other people. And so again, there's nothing wrong with money, but we can only serve one master. And so the amount of money we have is irrelevant when it comes to worrying about the future. The more we have, the more we're tempted to rely on ourselves and to worry about losing our wealth. The less we have, the more we worry about God's provision. And this is kind of the discussion that Jesus is having. But the immediate context here launches us into this discussion on worry and anxiety and fretting over the future. So the first thing that I want you to think about this morning is a refocus. Let's continue on. Matthew 6, 25. Follow along with me. Jesus says, therefore, I tell you, don't be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you'll put on. Is the life not more than food and the body not more than clothing? You know, I'm willing to bet that some of us from time to time need to refocus our thoughts and to refocus where our attention is placed. But that phrase, don't be anxious, the context here is Jesus is saying, stop what you're doing, aka stop worrying, and don't ever pick that back up again. In other words, just continually trust. Because we know, and Jesus knew this, because God designed us, that our worry and anxiety and fretting is not productive for us. Worry says, God, I really don't trust you. And did you know this? It only takes one cup of water to create a fog dense enough to cover seven city blocks. That's fascinating to me. One cup of water to create a fog dense enough to cover seven city blocks. And it's really the same way with us when it comes to worry. Something that is small gets magnified to epic proportions in our minds, and it blocks out God's presence in our lives, and it's hard to navigate in the fog. But worry is the opposite of contentment. I'm going to read the words of the Apostle Paul to you. You don't have to flip there. This is Paul writing to the Philippian church, Philippians 4, verses 11 through 12. He says, not that I'm speaking of being in need, for I've learned in whatever situation I am to be content. He says, I know how to be brought low and how to abound. In every circumstance, I've learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. You look at Paul's life. Paul went through a lot. shipwrecked, snake bit, beaten, stoned, whipped. Eventually, he'll be marched outside the city of Rome and have his head chopped off. But he says, you know what? I've learned through all circumstances just to rest in contentment with God. Because no matter how much we worry, it doesn't offer us anything productive. And I think truly the issue here at hand boils down to this, is do I really believe that what I believe is really real? And that's a lot, that's a mouthful. Let me say that again. Do I really believe that what I believe is really real? You know, sometimes it's easy to say, sure, God, I trust you. But when the rubber meets the road, this anxiety wells up in me, and I find myself looking with the future with anxiety. It really boils down, do I trust the Lord? I tell my kids all the time, because sometimes they're little sinners just like their dad, right? Now, their mom's not a sinner, but the kid, me and the kids, we're sinners. And sometimes they worry, and I tell them, look, you don't worry. That's my job, right? And it's the same way with us as Christians. I don't have to worry because I have a Father who will meet me in tomorrow. He holds our future. Continue on with me as we work through this passage. Look at verse 25. He says, again, verse 25, therefore I tell you, don't be anxious about your life, what you'll eat or what you'll drink, nor about your body, what you'll put on. Is life not more than food, and the body more than clothing? Again, Jesus is trying to reshift our focus from the cares that we have from day to day back to him. He says, you know, don't worry about all of these things. Yeah, they're important, they're necessities, but don't worry about them. You know, us as Americans, many of us don't have to worry about what we'll eat or what we'll wear because we're incredibly, incredibly blessed. Now, there are some who struggle, sure, but often we don't worry about that. When I open my closet, there are several shirts in there. I don't have to stress out about having clothes. But we should also know this, that as Americans that are incredibly blessed, we still worry from time to time. And we should also know that in some areas, it's not all going to work out and be fine, but still God will meet us in tomorrow. Into verse 25, he says, is not life more important than food and the body more important than clothes? Now plug in your words there. Is life not more important than career or retirement or grades or the house or the economy? Now, those things are important, sure. But Jesus says, are they life? They're not the importance. And then look down at verse 26. He says, look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable than they? Now, the second thought I want us to really have impressed upon us is for us to know our worth. Know your worth, Christian. Jesus is giving this sermon, and Jesus would often use these objects, and these birds fly over, and he says, hey, do you see these birds? He says, you know what? They don't punch a clock. They don't have to fret and you know, worry about their future, yet God takes care of them. You never met a bird that was worried about their retirement plan or a bird that was worried about what was to come? Incidentally speaking, do you know what you call a seagull that flies over the bay? It's a bagel. Sorry. Please don't fire me for that. But Jesus is teaching this object lesson. He says, you look to nature, and it doesn't fret and worry. You know, we have three dogs in our house, and sometimes I look at them, and I think, man, you lucky dogs. Because I fill their food cup up, my kids fill their water cup up, and they literally lay around all day without a care in the world. And I think, man, that must be so nice. And then I'm reminded that could be me too if I was willing to simply trust my heavenly Father. But Jesus says, you're more important than birds and dogs. Why is that? Because we bear the image of God. God designed you to be like him in many, many limited ways. God designs you to be in a relationship with the creator of the entire universe for his own glory. We are so much more valuable. We have to know our value to our heavenly Father. Continue on. Look at verse 27. He says, and which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to your lifespan? No matter how much we fret about the future, it's not going to make our life longer by even a second. In fact, it's just the opposite. Dr. Charles Mayo of the famous Mayo Clinic, this is what he writes. He says, worry affects the circulation, the heart, the glands, and the whole nervous system. I've never known someone to die of overwork, but I have known a lot who died of worry. In other words, you can literally worry yourself to death. Jesus points out the futility of our worry. Know your worth, Christian. You've got a daddy that cares about you and that loves you, and you don't have to fret because that is our Father's job. Continue on, verse 28. I'm sorry, yeah, 28. He says, and why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field and how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow the lawnmower rolls over it, will he not much more clothe you? He says, oh, you have little faith. Therefore, don't be anxious, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. Here's the amazing thing about God. God knows what you need before you even know you need it. God knows what you need even before you know you need it. It's the same way with my kids. You know, I know what they're going to need to make it through the day. Sometimes they come and ask me, and I'm like, I already got you covered. Holland will say, hey, Dad, will you get me a glass of milk? And the milk's already there, right? This is how God works. He knows our needs. But sometimes it's so easy for me to think about, well, what if? But then Jesus offers us the antidote for anxiety in verse 33. A famous verse, quoted often, you've heard it. He says this, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Jesus says, seek what matters. Keep your focus on where it should be, and that is the kingdom of God. Remember when we first started going through this series, we looked at Peter, and he swung his legs over the boat, and he says, Jesus asked me to come, and Jesus says, come on. And so Peter starts walking, and his focus is correct, and he's walking on water. What that must feel like, I have no idea. But then he takes his eyes off of Christ, and he starts to look at the waves and the wind, and he begins to sink. And it's the same way with our worry. When I take my focus off, when I stop seeking the kingdom of God, that's when I start to think about the what ifs. And I do. I find myself sinking into worry and difficulty. And I think we should also know this. Let's not forget this, that part of God's perfect plan was the sacrifice, suffering, and death of Christ. And sometimes for us as Christians, part of his plan for our lives is that we go through sometimes suffering. But here's what I know. No matter what we go through, God will meet us tomorrow. I've skipped to the end. I've read the back of the book, and it's going to work out fine for us that know the Lord. Last thought, and we're going to wrap up, is this. Don't let tomorrow rob you of today. Don't let tomorrow rob you of today. Verse 34, therefore, don't be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Now, Christians, should we make plans for tomorrow? Well, I hope so. Proverbs is full of, you know what, you better plan ahead, you better think ahead, you better be concerned about tomorrow. But Jesus teaches us this, do all you can and leave the results to the Lord. Be prepared and then just trust that your Heavenly Father knows your needs, that he loves you, that you're valuable to him, and that he is in control of all things. Our worry robs us of today. And I'm going to read, this is Isaiah 26, 3 through 4. The prophet writes this. He says, you keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts you. Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord is an everlasting rock. And so here's my question. Could we together trust the Lord with our future? As individuals, as families, as a corporate church body, that we lean on God and we say, you know what, I don't know what tomorrow holds. Tomorrow might be difficult, but God will meet me there. And so I don't have to worry about what is to come. So today we've noticed that you've got to refocus, that you've got to know your worth, that you're valuable to the Lord, created in his image, to seek what matters, which is God's kingdom. And don't let tomorrow rob you of all the joys and the blessings of today. I'm going to close out with a quote from Corrie Ten Boom. She says this. She says, worrying is carrying tomorrow's load with today's strength. Carrying 2 days at once. It's moving into tomorrow ahead of time. Worrying doesn't empty tomorrow of its sorrow. It empties today of its strength. And so, friends, would you trust the Lord in all areas of your life, but to know that he holds your future? And so your takeaway question is this. What is one specific area where I need to trust the Lord with my future? What is one specific area where I need to trust the Lord with my future? Whatever that is, the Lord will meet you in tomorrow. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we just come before you today thanking you so much for allowing us to be here, God. I am just so excited to be around people that love you, Lord, that like to sing praises to you. I don't know what we would do apart from you and apart from having other believers that come alongside us and that encourage us. And so, Lord, I pray that we would be faithful to encourage one another, not to fret and to get anxious and to worry, because we know you hold our future, Lord. I pray that you would just watch over us, guide us. I pray that everything we do would bring you honor and glory. I pray that our lives would be about seeking your kingdom first. Lord, we pray all these things, ask that you watch over us today. All these things we pray in your name. Amen.
We'll be right back.
with chairs a little bit. That'd be terrific. Also, don't forget the picnic is going to start here in just a few moments. On your way out the door, meet somebody you've never met before and let them know how glad you are that they're here today. God bless you.